أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، وصلى الله وسلم على رسوله ومصطفاه الأمين نبينا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين. In the name of Allah, the most beneficent, the most merciful, I do bear witness that there is no God but Allah. There is no God but Allah. لا إله إلا الله. I bear witness that Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم is the last and final messenger of Allah. May all the peace, blessings, and salutations of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala be upon Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم, his family, his companions, men and women, old and young, Arabs and non-Arabs, and upon us, you and me, and our loved ones and families, until the Day of Judgment. Ameen. Ameen. I ask Allah victory to our sisters and brothers in Palestine. I ask Allah to grant them malaika from the sky to support them the way the malaika supported Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the Sahaba during the Battle of Badr. Ameen. Ya Rab, all people on earth have left the Mujahideen in Palestine and refuse or are unable to support them and help them as a Muslim should be. But no one can stop you, Ya Allah. You are the most powerful. You are the omnipotent. You are the all-powerful, all-able, all-capable to do anything you want. May you, Ya Rab, send malaika from the sky to support our brothers and sisters in Palestine during their jihad. Feed them, Ya Allah. Provide for them from what they never expected. Feed them, Ya Allah. Clothe them. Send them medicine. Send them water. Send them weapons. Send them whatever they need as they are defending your house, Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa, and defending your blessed land, and defending their honor, their religion, their people, their children. Ya Rab, you promised to be always on the side of those who stand by you. Please stand by them and show us what you can do to these kuffar who are also supporting them behind seven oceans. Ya Rab, show us what you can do to these governments. Punish them, Ya Rab, severely. The hypocrites also surrounding Palestinians. Ameen, 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 Ya Rab. Okay. One or two questions before we start the class, before we start the book. Let me give some time for few questions, general questions, any question.
Assalamu alaikum, Shaykh.
Salam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Shay, last night I came across this one short video stating that we Muslims not supposed to attend any of weddings that like our Christian friends, our Hindu friends' wedding. How is it true, Shay, on this?
It depends. I am 100% pro non-Muslim, Hindu and Buddhist, you should not attend because they are mushriks. Also, Christians, it depends what they do. If, for example, they are inviting you just for a banquet, just to eat and go, I think you should go. But if they are going to do some kind of rituals, like holding the cross, doing certain ibadat, so then you don't go. So, because there are Christians and Christians. So you should ask, may I know what's the program? If they say just food, makan, say congratulations to the bride and groom and leave, that's fine. But are they dressed properly? You know what I mean? Is liquor going to be served there? All these things, it's better to avoid. If you don't know quite well what might be on the program, you better not go. You just say sorry, and you send a gift later on, or you congratulate this colleague or neighbor or whatever your way. Not everybody can come, so you can go later on and say congratulations your way. Meaning, I'm not against your marriage. I'm against what may happen during the ceremonies and this and that. Well, in Islam, any marriage is good. Even Hindu, Buddhist, Christian, Jewish, the marriage itself. A man proposes to a woman and a woman agrees. That's good. Better than zina. But what might be done, you are not allowed to go, even if it's a Muslim wedding. I repeat, two Muslims getting married, but there is liquor. There are, by the way. I know. So you are not supposed to be there. It's haram. It's a form of condoning, form of agreeing with liquor, with women not dressed properly. And these are Muslim women, let alone Christian or Jews or Hindus or Buddhists. So it is what is done during the ceremony of the marriage that makes it haram. Not because it's Christian wedding. Some Christians don't wear crazy clothes, and they don't eat pork, and they don't serve liquor. And just the man comes with his wife, they give him his wife, congratulations, and people go eat and then leave. If this is, I say go. But if more than that, if somebody is going to carry beer in his hand, then you are not supposed to be there. Yeah, I agree with whoever sent that video.
Sheikh, another question, Sheikh, short one. Paying last respect to a friend or to a family members who have not yet revert a church, you know, to pay the last respect, yeah.
Meaning he died?
He died.
He or she died, okay? Yeah. So can we go, you mean to there?
To the church. To the funeral or to the church. Normally they put the body there.
Yes, can. But you stand, you just pass, just look at the body and move out. That's permissible, no problem. But that doesn't mean you are agreeing with, but you should not wear special dress. For example, no black. If they say the suit should be black, you should not wear black. You should go as you wear usually, with the same cloth of the day. Let's say you were wearing black that day, that's fine. You don't change. You don't go home, change for the occasion. And this is very important, even for Islam, even for Muslims. We should not wear special dress. That means there is janazah. That's bid'ah. Number two, you can go give your condolences to the family. And better if you can go to the graveyard when they bury him or her. That's it. Better than to go to the church. You go to the graveyard and they bury him or her. You give your condolences to his wife or to his family, and then you walk away. More than this, most ulama said no, because the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam told Ali radiallahu anhu, go bury your father. So he allowed Ali to even go and bury his own father, Abu Talib. Then he ordered him to ghusl. He said, make ghusl. Abu Talib died kafir. And it's Ali radiallahu anhu who buried his father. Not the Prophet. The Prophet refused. Because if he did so, all of us have to go. You know what I mean? The Prophet is an example to follow, but not Ali. Ali is not an example to follow. May Allah be pleased with him. So he said, you can go and bury your father. Meaning you can go and bury your friend, your business partner, whoever passed away. But you do ghusl again. Mandi, ghusl again. But to go to the church while people are holding a cross and people are doing things, better not, unless these people, they don't do that. They just put the body in a gasket and people pass, look at him, and then, you know, just, that's fine. There is nothing wrong with that.
Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Assalamu rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Sorry, Sheikh, I can't talk much because I have toothache. But anyway, what if my mother, because she doesn't have any more siblings, but she's not yet revert. I'm trying my best.
But, may Allah guide her. May Allah guide her. Yes.
I mean. But let's see if she goes first.
Yeah.
And there's no one. And three of her daughters are all reverts. Alhamdulillah.
Alhamdulillah.
Yeah. But so how is that? She then the burial, and then we have to go into the church, and we have to sit there throughout the you know the
Did she give you wasiya? Did she said bury me Christian if I die?
Yeah, she's still a staunch one.
Yeah. Okay. Why you girls don't tell her, ma, look, the person you love so much, Jesus, peace be upon him, we also love him. And show her all the verses in the Quran about Jesus.
Yeah,
I like them. You did that.
Yeah. I even give her the, in fact, I even told her, Mariah, I even normally will salam her and everything, and I'll tell her, mom, I cried, and also she cried, and said, my wish one day is to bring you to Makkah. I told her that.
MashaAllah.
And she just cried. I cried. You know, talking about this also gives me the tears.
Yeah. May Allah guide her. Keep visiting her. Keep talking to her. I know I told you one of my students in the US, her mom was a very strong Catholic woman. After 27 years, she became Muslim. 27 years. MashaAllah. Yeah.
So that's
it can happen. Anyways, if this doesn't happen, if this doesn't happen, by the way, if she just said Shahada, then you bury her as Muslim. Yeah. If she just said Shahada and dies, you must take her to Masjid al-Taqwa or wherever, wash her body and bury her as Muslim.
The thing is that she, my mother knows about, because I have my granddaughter, and she feeds my granddaughter. She's most of the time in my house. And she will tell my daughter, my granddaughter says like, okay, Sophia, what must you say first before you eat? You must say your Bismillah, right? She knows all that. She knows that you need to pray, even if my children, they take their time to go and pray their fardu. They say, hey, why are your children not praying yet? You know, all those things she knows. And she always say, when I'm down, she will say, go and pray. Ask God. She knows all those things, but it's just that the Shahada, that's the thing. Yeah.
Yeah, keep telling her. Just say, ma, repeat after me. I bear witness that there is no God but Allah. I bear witness that Muhammad, messenger of Allah. I bear witness Isa is the messenger of Allah. I bear witness Musa is messenger of Allah. If she says this, alhamdulillah. Just help her. Maybe you are not requesting, ma, repeat after me.
Yeah, I have to do
and
more.
And give her a gift.
I have to
really give her a gift before, make her very happy, whatever gift makes her happy, and tell her, ma, I have a request. You have to repeat after me the following words. You never know. You never know. Anyways, but God forbid, if she insists on not saying Shahada and she dies non-Muslim, you can go to the church as girls. It's okay. And you bury her in the cemetery of Christians. You have to do still. And your husband, brother, Zachary and your other sisters' husbands, if they have, also should go with you guys.
Yeah, I used to have an ustaz who comes over to do tadabbur in my house. And she's very keen in listening. Every Sunday, she will get herself dressed up except for no jilbab. She'll wear the abaya and she'll just sit down and listen.
Okay, then
Yes.
no one maybe asked her. Maybe no one went to her and sealed the deal, as we say. You should come and say, Salaamu Alaikum Hajja. Let's say if me, I will go and say, hey, beautiful young lady, what's up? Huh? Ready? Ready to do what? To run with me, jogging. Come, let's go. And talk to her, psychology. She's done, Malu, who's this guy? Who's this? He must be crazy, Sheikh. And then say, Salaamu Alaikum Hajja. I also love Jesus. The same one who sent Jesus sent Muhammad, Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam. Are you ready? Ready. Put your finger like this. Yalla, up. Okay. Yeah, say after me. Like that. Maybe the first day, slowly, next time she starts looking for this crazy Sheikh to come and play with her again, because he said psychology, and seal the deal. Let's do it. Say Shahada after me. With a girl, ma, please, miss, ma, please, just say, and she may say it. Alhamdulillah, khalas. Then Allah may forgive her just for saying it. We need to.
Inshallah, Sheikh.
Okay? Do that. Do this approach. Seal the deal. You know, sometimes the person is ready. It's just we did not ask him to, yalla, buy. He wants to buy, but say, okay, how do you want to pay? Cash or credit card? Like that. So you want to say it like in what? In Chinese? Ching chong 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 chang chang? Satu? Like that. Or in Malay or in Arabic? Or she speaks English, your mom?
Yeah, she's a very staunch, Roman Catholic.
Okay. Very good.
Inshallah, she.
And tell her, your love of Jesus will always be there in Islam. Because that's what they're afraid of. Say, look, ma, by becoming Muslim, your love to Jesus will not go away. In the contrary, it becomes even better. But he's not son of God. God doesn't have sons. He is the messenger of Allah. Do you know what is messenger of God? To be chosen to be messenger? Huh? Show her the Surat Maryam. Yeah. Can she read? Can she still read?
Yeah.
Her eyes are good? Good.
Yeah.
Show her Surat Maryam. Just give her Surat Maryam. Open the Quran, Surah 12. That's all. Let her read. Because she already knows the story, but she doesn't know it the Quran way. She knows it the church's way. And it's very emotional. It touches the emotions of the reader. And being a mother, she will relate to Mary. Peace be upon her. How can she give birth? Just like that. Yes, that's the miracle. So she's a mother. She gave birth to you. She gave birth to your sisters. So she will start getting the, inshallah, the attraction. May Allah guide her. May Allah guide her. Okay, let's start our class, inshallah. But the answer, yes, you can go to the church and take good care of her until she is buried, and then you come back. Okay. I believe we stopped at page 75. Seventy-six. Allah loves the beneficial.
74. We stop at just before the Surah Ar-Rahman, verse
Okay.
4.
No problem. Go to 76. Okay, there. Yes, Allah loves the beneficial. So we need to know that every ni'mah is from Allah. Every ni'mah, meaning every favor, every bounty, every benefit we are enjoying comes from Allah and Allah alone, nobody else. So never ever attribute the favors to people. It is Allah who sent you that person to help you. You should thank that person, but you should not attribute to him or her the ni'mah. The ni'mah comes from Allah. Is this clear? Okay. Yalla. Now, let me see who are the students present today. Okay. Sister Nina. Sister Nina.
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Alaikum salam.
My sincere apologies, but where I am, it's not convenient for me to
speak. Okay. No problem.
Sorry.
No problem. Then it is Brother Zakri. Okay. Brother Zakri, go ahead, please read.
Bismillah. Allah loves the beneficial. We saw in Hadith 4 how we could come nearer to Allah by adopting the qualities of His names and attributes. Since Allah is the one who blesses all, He loves those who benefit others and alleviate their hardships. This Hadith teaches us that we can attain the love of Allah by helping those around us in whatever way possible. This was how the prophets of Allah lived. Allah described Prophet Jesus alayhi salam as a source of constant blessings. Allah said,
وَجَعَلَنِي مُبَارَكًا أَيْنَمَا كُنْتُ.
And He made me, Jesus, a blessing wherever I may be. Jesus alayhi salam radiated benefits. No matter where He went and whom He met, His presence was a blessing, injecting benefit wherever He was. He taught the truth, made dua for the afflicted, assisted the needy, commanded virtue, and spoke out against evil, and was patient with His opponents. This was how all the prophets of Allah, alayhi wasallam, were. And this was how the companions of the Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, were. The Prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, once asked,
قال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من أصبح منكم اليوم صائما قال أبو بكر رضي الله عنه أنا قال فمن تبع منكم اليوم جنازة قال أبو بكر رضي الله عنه أنا قال فمن أطعم منكم اليوم مسكينا قال أبو بكر رضي الله عنه أنا قال فمن عاد منكم اليوم مريضا قال أبو بكر رضي الله عنه أنا فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم ما اجتمعنا في امرئ إلا دخل الجنة.
Who fasted among you today? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied, I did. He asked, who among you followed a funeral today? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied, I did. He asked, who among you fed a poor person today? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied, I did. He asked, who among you visited a sick person today? Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu replied, I did. So the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, anyone in whom these good deeds are combined will enter Jannah.
Allahu Akbar. Alhamdulillah.
What would prompt a person to do so much good in one day? Loving Allah and loving His servants in this is the answer. When one tastes the love of Allah, they would naturally gravitate towards what Allah loves. They will be looking for every opportunity to do what Allah loves. Every good deed is one step closer to Allah. Every good deed is more of Allah's love that we get to feel and enjoy. Every good deed is a gift. that Allah sent us to get closer to Him. And when one feels love and compassion towards Allah's creation, they cannot sit back and not help. If we love the ones whom Allah loves, we cannot see them in pain and do nothing. Allah's beloved are an extension of Allah's mercy and love, a conduit for His blessings, spreading goodness wherever they are, and searching for the opportunity to help. This person is from the people of Jannah. If we desire to attain the love of Allah, we should care for Allah's creation. Allah made all this, and it is clear to Him. So how will you take care of His precious love?
And it is dear to Him.
And it is dear to Him. So how will you take care of what is precious to Allah? This is where the righteous demonstrate their love for Allah. And for the seeker of righteousness, as Ibn Tamiyah, Rahimullah, wrote.
Very good. Before I read this, sisters and brothers, go back to the hadith of Abu Bakr. Very good. There. What did Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu do? Camera on me, please. Camera on me. Good. Everybody, what did Abu Bakr as-Siddiq do? Look at the hadith and answer. Number one, he fasted. The Prophet asked, who is fasting today? The Sahaba don't lie. Nobody raised his hand except Abu Bakr. He said, I am fasting today, O Messenger of Allah. Okay, so ibadah of fasting. Good, right? Why someone fast? Because he loves Allah. Allah loves fasting. That's why you're fasting. One way is to express your love to Allah is to fast. Monday, Thursday, Arafah, Ashura, 6 days of Shawwal, few days of Dhul Hijjah. Do you understand? 3 days of when the moon is full. Your fast is an expression of love to Allah. That's number one. Number two, who amongst you follow the funeral today? It was Fajr, by the way. When the Prophet asked these questions, it was Fajr. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq woke up before Fajr and helped someone to bury one of his loved ones. So what did Abu Bakr do, number two? Quick, answer me.
Went to the funeral burial.
Very good. What does that mean? He benefited someone. Our subject is what? Allah loves the beneficial, right? When you benefit someone, Allah loves you. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq went out of his way to benefit someone by helping him bury a loved one. Do you see? So the first one is love of Allah. The second one, he is benefiting someone. He is being helpful to someone. Number three, who amongst you fed a poor person? Abu Bakr said, I. He already fed. Before Fajr, he gave sadaqah, food. Again, that is benefiting others. Number three, he benefited someone. Funeral is benefiting someone. Feeding someone poor is benefiting someone poor. Number four, who amongst you visited a sick person today before Fajr? Allahu Akbar. It was Abu Bakr as-Siddiq again who raised his hand because he cannot lie. If you hide, if you don't say, it means you are. The Prophet is asking, you have to answer. And all the Sahaba were looking at Abu Bakr like, mashallah. You did all this, brother. The day didn't even start. And then he said, who amongst you has benefited someone sick by visiting him, looking after him, bringing some joy to him. So all these things lead to where? To Jannah, benefiting others. You see where more pahala is? I may pray two rak'ahs, but that's pahala only to me. But when I go feed someone, when I go help my mother, when I run an errand for my father, when I help my neighbor, when I teach people, when you do a humanitarian job, you are benefiting people. And this is not given to anyone. So you have to focus on this type of ibadah where you benefit others. Never say no when somebody needs you for help. You give a loan to someone, you are benefiting him or her. Somebody is trying to marry his son or daughter and you help somehow. You go out of your way and you are always there to help. That's a big thing. You follow janaza, you wash a body, you dig the grave, you renovate someone's house, you fix someone's wall, you fix someone's fence, you remove a tree from the road. A tree or a branch fell. Why do you ignore it? Why you just pass? There would be people, traffic jam. So remove that branch, at least push it back to the trees so that the traffic doesn't become bad. Common sense. Common sense. Somebody, you see a blind person trying to cross the street. And you are crossing anyways. You are also crossing. Hold him from his hand and cross the road, the street. If you are not crossing and you stop to help him or her, that's even better. MashaAllah. You see an elderly carrying a bag, heavy, a grocery store, grocery. You help. So you benefit people. Sisters and brothers, yesterday I saw a short video. You know in the Caucasus, you know Caucasus? Caucasus, Dagestan, Chechnya, Uzbekistan. This Muslim, mashallah, countries that were under Russia. Do you know when an elderly walks to the office, all the youth have to stand up until he leaves? It's very, very, very bad to sit down when an elderly man walks in. He doesn't need to see it. Look, I'm an old man. I walk and people are sitting. And there is plenty of seats where I can sit. But I just walked in. Everybody has to get up. Out of respect. Do we have this now? And he's just coming to ask something and leave. Huh? He's not coming to wait. We have lost a lot of adab. A lot of akhlaq. He's not even asking you to help him. He walks in, everybody up. MashaAllah. MashaAllah, MashaAllah. Okay, so remember what made Abu Bakr as-Siddiq so special. The fact that he benefits others. And there is no Sahabi after the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam who has benefited Islam and Muslims more than Abu Bakr as-Siddiq. Radiallahu anhu. Followed by Khadija. Radiallahu anha. May Allah be pleased with her. Because they use their money for Allah's sake. Abu Bakr freed 10 slaves who were under torture. They were condemned to death. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq saved 10 slaves. One of them is the famous Bilal radiyallahu anhu. So he benefited others. So when Allah gives you money or fame or position, sister and brother, what are you doing with those fame and positions? What? You are just being called a title? You are a dato, or you are a tansri, or you are a tun, or dato sri for no reason? Just a title? Use that title for Allah's sake. You are a manager. You are a director. You are a CEO. You are a CFO. You are whatever Allah made you. Imagine Sheikh like me doesn't teach. Why am Sheikh then? Why Allah gave me some knowledge? So that I look at the mirror and talk to myself. Or teach people day and night, morning. I don't have day off. You know that, guys. Do you understand? So when Allah gives you, you have to benefit others. Even when He doesn't give you. You don't have money. I have time. I go with you. I speak Malay. You need translation in immigration. I go with you. What do you need? You need to pay to change the title on your name from Tenaga Nacional. I go with you. You want to go to Ayers Langor? I go with you. Because I speak the language, maybe easy. You want to go to police to make a report, somebody wrong you, go. You want to go to hospital, I go with you. Things like that. That is what Allah loves the most among all the ibadahs, because you are benefiting someone. You're helping someone. Huh? Remember that. So that's what the author is telling us, that we should desire to attain the love of Allah in what pleases Allah the most, which is benefiting His creation. Continue, brother Zakri. Ibn Taymiyyah said, "Man ahabba an yalhaqa bi darajati al-abrar." 78, yes. "Man ahabba an yalhaqa bi darajati al-abrar wa yatashabbaha bil akhyar falyanwi في كل يوم تطلع فيه الشمس نفع الخلق."
The one who loves to reach the rank of the pious and imitate the righteous should intend to benefit creation every single day. That is...
Allahu Akbar. Hold on. Allahu Akbar. Look at me. Look at me. This is very beautiful. Very, very beautiful. Ibn Taymiyyah is Sheikh al-Islam. The greatest Sheikh of Islam is Ibn Taymiyyah. He said, look, just make niyyah. Every morning, make niyyah. I want to benefit some people. Every morning when you get up, say, inshallah, ya Rab, please give me the chance to benefit people. That's all you do. Make niyyah. You become righteous. You want to become among ahl al-taqwa, ahlul birr, ahlul maghfira. Intend that today, ya Rab, help me to help some people. Guide me to help some people. Even if it doesn't happen, you intended. So every day you are getting closer to that level until you reach it because of your intention. How about when you intend and do? See? Very simple. Yeah, continue, please.
That is, wake up each day with the intention of helping someone. Look for them and jump at the opportunity to help. It is a true gift when Allah sends someone your way and you happen to be the one who can help. It is a gift from Allah to you. The greatest gift we can give is spreading Islam and Islamic knowledge. It is the best gift because it is beneficial in this life and the next. This was the mission of the prophets of Allah, and how they were the most helpful. Next comes bringing happiness to the life of a Muslim by removing their hardship. Some will need money, but others need reconciliation with loved ones, mediation to remove injustice or advice. Finally, if we love Allah's creation, we will not hurt them. We will hold back our evil and rage, for the sake of Allah. If we cannot help, at least we should not hurt. Loving the servants of Allah means desiring the best for them, living for them what we love for ourselves. If we were in hardship, would we not want someone to help? Well, this is what they need from you and me. The comparison that the Prophet ﷺ made is fascinating. Many of us wish to travel and pray at the Prophet's mosque in Medina, motivated by the great reward for praying there and by our love for him. We dream about it, save money for it, and are elated when it finally happens. Can you imagine how beautiful a month's stay in the Prophet's mosque would be? But this is not possible for many of us. What is incredible is that something better than that is available to all of us. Helping people is better than staying at the Prophet's mosque for a whole month. The merit and advantages of staying at the Prophet's mosque are paramount. So it goes to show how much Allah loves it when we help people, if it is better than worship for a whole month at that cherished mosque.
Very good. Now, everybody pay attention, please. The greatest benefit you can ever do to people is spreading knowledge. This is why nobody matches the reward of ulama. The ulama are in the place of prophets. The prophets were teaching and guiding people. The ulama, Allah brought them to do the same. So the number one good deed that Allah loves is spreading knowledge, teaching people, teaching them the Quran, teaches them the hadith, teaching them the seerah, teaching them ulum al-Quran, teaching them fiqh, teaching them everything related to dunya and akhir. Alhamdulillah. Number two, the most important amal you do after spreading knowledge is bringing happiness to someone's life. You make somebody happy. Huh? Just bring happiness. Somebody is in need of money, you give money. A poor person is begging. When you give him money, he's happy. You feed somebody hungry. You counsel somebody who is having a problem. You reconcile between two people. Husband and wife, brother and brother, sister and sister having problems, neighbor and neighbor. You come and do peace. You bring them together back. So you brought happiness. Didn't you? Yes, somebody was hungry and you made him eat. He's very happy. Somebody was sick or in pain and you took him to the doctor. The doctor gave injection or medicine and now he feels better. He's so happy. You give a gift to your wife, to your spouse, to your children, to your parents, to your in-laws. What did you do? Spreaded happiness. You brought happiness. You buy lunch for your best friend. You don't tell him, Sudamakan, and leave him. There is no Sudamakan. What is this Sudamakan? Sudamakan? Okay, bye. Why did you ask me then, Sudamakan or not? Stop this Sudamakan, guys. Sudamakan means I'm paying you lunch for you or dinner. It's not Sudamakan and goodbye. I was shocked. First time it happened to me. Sudamakan? I said, Belum. Okay. Bye. It took me 2 hours to realize that I am in Malaysia. Don't do that. Stop it. If you ask someone, have you eaten or not, be ready to pay. If he says, no, I didn't eat, you just leave like that. But Sheikh, this is our culture. Stop it, stop it. Culture is not God, okay? Culture things that don't make sense, leave them. Have you eaten? No. Okay, bye. When I remember it, it takes me time to come to peace. May Allah forgive you all. Okay. So somebody may need anything. When you fulfill that need, you brought so much happiness and joy. That's what Allah loves. It's called Jabrul Khawatir. Somebody is worried. You sit with him or her and make them not worry. Halas. Something. And then you just give advice. No, it's not that. It's not going to be like this. You should. Alhamdulillah, you just care. You didn't give money. You just gave a few words of hikmah. Very, very important. So bringing joy to people's heart. Also, loving the servants of Allah is very important. Somebody is serving Allah. You must love him or her. Somebody, all his life teaching, all his life jihad, all his life sadaqah, all his life humanitarian work, all his life, I don't know what he or she do, ana yatim, all their life, mashallah, masjid. They are always at the masjid, preparing the masjid, vacuuming the masjid, cleaning the masjid for you to come and pray and not flush the toilet. Some Muslims, idiots, they do that. How can you not flush the toilet, brother? How come? You enter the toilet, you find it clean. Leave it clean. And then, loving this type of people who do serve Allah is wajib. It's no joke. It's no joke. We need to learn this because we have forgotten. We think, oh, they are just doing. No. We must love them and respect them. Yeah? And also, remember the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which I shared with you many times earlier, where he said, I better go with someone at his service, rendering a service to a Muslim dearer to me and better in reward than 1 month i'tikaf in my masjid, Masjid Nabawi, Masjid of Medina. You all know that hadith, right? If not, you know it now. The Prophet said, if I go with a Muslim somewhere, let's say to the market, and help him get groceries to his family, give him a ride or walk with him or help him carry things, simple thing, is better in reward than i'tikaf in the masjid of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam for 1 month. Allahu Akbar. So if I go with you to take your son to the hospital because he had a bad accident or twisted his ankle or broke his leg, I just go with you, give you companionship, put him in emergency and wait until they fix him or her and they give us that child. That is more in reward than i'tikaf of 1 month in Masjid Nabawi. Allahu Akbar. Do you know what does it mean, i'tikaf in one masjid, in the Masjid al-Nabawi? Each salat, 1,000 prayer. Subuh equals 1,000 subuh here in Malaysia or elsewhere. Dhuhr, same. Asr, same. Maghrib, same. 1 month. Besides i'tikaf, reading Quran, dhikr, this and that, there is something more than that for 1 month. Just to go with the Muslim, to help him or her get something. Because you are benefiting that person. While in i'tikaf, you are benefiting only yourself. I'm not saying you should not do ibadah of i'tikaf. I'm saying there are other ibadahs more beneficial to you in reward because you are benefiting others. So remember that. Any question, feel free now to ask me. Don't let me go. Ask now. Very good. Continue, Brother Zakri.
Be kind as Allah was kind to you. Allah is very gracious to us. He secures our basic needs and gives beyond what we deserve, all without requesting anything in advance. He gave it all out of his generosity and love. Part of the gratitude we owe him is sharing his gifts and spreading goodwill. Allah said,
وَأَحْسِنْ كَمَا أَحْسَنَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْكَ.
And do good as Allah has done good to you. Sharing what we have only blesses it. We share some of our money when we pay zakah, and the rest of the gifts of Allah have their zakah too. If Allah taught you something, teach it. This is the zakah of knowledge. The more that you teach, the more your understanding will grow and flourish. If you have a skill, share it. If you are healthy, help the sick. If you are a professional, use your position to make people's lives better. And as you share, remember that you are truly blessed. Blessed to receive, but also blessed to give. The gifts of Allah grow when we are generous with them.
Which is very true. Sisters and brothers, what makes a tree, grow stronger? When a plant becomes even stronger?
The roots.
The roots, true, but?
The leaves, you have to trim them.
Excellent, yeah. Excellent. You have to get rid of some branches and leaves. Then it starts becoming grow. Did you realize that or not? Some of you are not farmers. Some of you never touch a plant. When you see plant, you are tackled. What is this? Sisters. Rambut. Hair grows when you remove it. It grows even stronger. So there is a law. Whatever Allah gave you, give from it. It will grow. When your money will grow, after zakat, subhanallah, do that. What makes your money even grow more is?
Sadaqah.
Excellent, Mariaton. Well done. Because sadaqah is not wajib. Sadaqah is optional. Zakat is wajib. So Allah promised, you give zakat, I will increase your risk. But sadaqah is even more. More barakah start coming. Money coming from everywhere. Whoa. And blessings. Same thing. You are healthy. What to do? You look at the gym. You go to the gym and start flexing your muscles. Look like a... When you are healthy, you go help the poor. You help the sick. You help the needy. Use your health to help. When you are skillful, use your skill. When you are professional, use your profession to help others. So whatever Allah gave you, use it. That is one way to thank Allah. One way to thank God is not just say, Alhamdulillah wa shukru lillah. That is by tongue. Is I use my health, I use my knowledge, I use my money, I use everything Allah gave me. So the word my, I shouldn't use it. Better word, I use Allah's money, I use Allah's health that he gave me. I use Allah's profession, skills, whatever Allah gave me to thank him, to benefit others. to benefit others. Now Allah loves you. Now you start entering this world. And this is the proof you love Allah. The proof you love Allah, when you help others. When you help only yourself, you are very selfish. When you care only about yourself, you see someone struggling, you don't help him or her. Struggling, huh? Not lazy. Trying to work hard. He works his lungs and kidney, as we say. You don't help him or her. What type of Muslim you are then? So that's the sign you love Allah, because Allah loves the beneficial and benefactors. Remember that. So far, mashallah, Allah loves beauty. So look after your beauty and do beautiful things. Look after your look, your physical, as well as your heart, eh? The beauty of the heart. Also do beautiful things. When you do something, do it as beautiful as you can. When you do a job, do it perfect. Number two, Allah loves ease. Be easy on people. Don't be tough. Don't be rough. Don't be difficult. Allah loves ease. When you buy and sell, be easy. Don't make it difficult for people. When you travel, travel in an easy way. Some of you, when they travel, as if they are moving. Why do you take 666 bag with you while you are going just for 1 week? Ladies have this problem, right or wrong? But Sheikh, we wear too much clothes than you. And then you go there, you don't wear any clothes. You even buy more clothes. You're laughing, I'm sure. Take some clothes and go, and that's it. Wash them later on. Be easy. Ya Azizi. Allah loves excellence. When you do something, do it perfect. When you wash the dishes, not just like that. No, wash nice. Let them shine. When you do any job, do it as much close to perfection. Allah loves gentleness. Allah loves harmony. Allah loves benefactors. These are the things we have so far covered. Now we're going to start another thing Allah loves so much. Forgiving. Forgive. Look at me. People wronged you. Yes, they wronged you. They were bad. They were nasty. They hurt you. But if you forgive them, you are better. If you forgive them, you are better million times than them. Especially if they ask you. If they come and say, sorry, brother, sorry, sister. May Allah forgive us. Please, ma'af, zahir dan batin, please forgive me. Forgive me for wronging you that day. For this. They have to also apologize. But even if they don't apologize and you want to forgive, you are much better than them. And it's good for you. I will show you that forgiving, I prove to you that forgiveness is good for you, the one who forgives. Dunya and akhirah. Not just in the hereafter, but in dunya. You do what we call what's that word? Who can read my lips?
Tough, Sheikh, tough. Try again, Sheikh.
Yes, Nina, very good. Move on. You move on. You are not stuck in the past. You are not prisoner of that bad experience that happened to me in 1914. 1914, the beginning of World War I, and you are still talking about it. World War III is about to start, and you are move on. Halas, that man did this to me, Sheikh. That wife did this to me. My partner, move on. Move on. So it's good for you. You move on. People see you happy. You strong. You pass with all that pain or whatever injustice people did to you. You are living your life while they are still biting their fingers. Let them bite all their toes, even their toes. They go down to their feet and bite. But you move on because you're strong. You trust Allah. And you're happy with whatever you are enjoying now and what is coming. Don't live in the past. Eh? So forgiving is a very good way to let go of the past. Because some of you love to live in the past. Because you are weak. You couldn't move on. Okay? So hadith number 8, page 81, everyone. Allah loves forgiveness. Well done, Zakri, as always. May Allah bless you. Now, let me see another sister or brother to read. How about Brother Ahmad Satali?
Assalamu alaikum, Sheikh.
Wa alaikum assalam wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. I will read the Arabic and you read the English, inshallah. Allah loves forgiveness. قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها يا رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أرأيت إن وافقت ليلة القدر ما أدعو قال صلى الله عليه وسلم تقولين اللهم إنك عفو تحب العفو فاعف عني. Go ahead, brother.
Aisha رضي الله عنها asked, O Messenger of Allah, what should I supplicate if I happen to be in the night of Qadr? He sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, you say, O Allah, you are oft pardoning, you love to pardon, so pardon me.
Very good.
Allah loves to forgive and loves it when we forgive. Allah's forgiveness does not happen out of need, but out of love and mercy. And it demonstrates how much Allah cares about us and wants the best for us. Allah is of pardoning. Allah loves mercy, loves to forgive, and loves repentance and the repentant. Allah's mercy is so vast that all other mercy in this universe is from it. His mercy is so vast that it covers everything. Allah said,
وَرَحْمَتِي وَسِعَتْ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ.
And my mercy encompasses all. Al-Araf, Ayah 56. 156. The angels closest to Allah, who carry his throne, know and testify to the extent of his mercy when they say in the Quran,
رَبَّنَا وَسِعْتَ كُلَّ شَيْءٍ رَحْمَةً وَعِلْمًا.
O our Rabb, you have encompassed all in mercy and knowledge. Surah Ghafir, Ayah 7. Mm-hmm. As Allah's knowledge reaches all and nothing escapes it, so does his mercy cover all. Even the non-believers who opposes Allah with words and deeds is a recipient of this mercy every single minute of the day. To illustrate the depth of Allah's mercy, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said,
إِنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَ يَوْمَ خَلَقَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضَ مِئَةَ رَحْمَةٍ كل رحمة طباق ما بين السماء والأرض فجعل منها في الأرض رحمة فبها تعطف الوالدة على ولدها والوحش والطير بعضها على بعض فإذا كان يوم القيامة أكملها بهذه الرحمة.
When Allah created the heavens and the earth, He created 100 mercies. Each mercy fills what is between the sky and the earth. And He placed one of the mercies on earth, and it is thought it, and it is through it that a matter is merciful, or a mother is merciful with her child, and animals and birds are merciful with each other. And on the day of resurrection, He completes the 99 with this mercy.
Very good.
Yeah.
Okay. Now, everybody, pay attention, please. Allah is the most forgiving, right? We all know that. Al-Ghafur. One of the names of Allah, Al-Ghafur, Ghafir, Al-Ghaffar. Al-Ghafur, Ghafir, Al-Ghaffar. Meaning, don't worry, He will forgive. In dunya, before you die. And He will forgive you during death. And He will forgive you after death. If you die Muslim. If you die Muslim, okay. Now, when Allah forgives, out of need or out of love?
Love.
Of course not out of need, because Allah doesn't have any need. Very good. This doesn't need to even any thinking. You and me, when we forgive, can we forgive out of need? Yes. You and me, humans, if we forgive, can we forgive because we need? Yes. I need your money. That's why I'm forgiving you for what you have done. I need a job. I need you to take care of my son who is overseas. I may forgive you for certain things. So I have needs. So I may forgive you for needs. Allah doesn't forgive you for needs because Allah has no needs. Allah forgives you for love. And the human also can forgive for love. A mother forgives you just because she loves you. A father forgives you, doesn't need you. He forgives you because he's your dad. A husband forgives his wife because he loves her. A wife forgives her husband because she loves him. Do you understand? But we are different than Allah. Allah forgives out of love, just because he loves you. He forgives you. You and me, we forgive because we love and because we need. This is very important. Both forgiving are highly high. You forgive out of need or you forgive out of love. Both of them are, inshallah, good for the human. But which one is higher? Huh? Which one is higher?
Love.
Very good. Forgiving out of love. To who? Look at me. I am forgiving you, although I don't like you. So it's not because I love you. I'm forgiving you because I love who?
Allah.
You see why you should always have Allah? Umar ibn al-Khattab told the person who killed his brother. Umar had a good brother. Somebody killed him. And then he came and became Muslim. He asked him to forgive me. He said, please forgive me, brother. I killed your brother. He said, I forgive you, but I don't want to see you. Please, when you see me, just don't let me see you. He said, I will forgive you. Meaning, I will not I will not look for revenge. I will not kill you. Don't worry. I promise. But I just don't want to see you. I don't want that you sit in front of me. If you ever attend my khutbah or my dars, don't let me eye to eye. That's all. It will change my mood. So he forgave him for Allah's sake. Otherwise, Umar could kill him. Umar was the caliph. Do you understand? So I want my sisters and brothers to understand one thing about forgiveness, because most of us don't understand what is forgiveness. To forgive is one of the highest forms of taqwa. And Allah loves forgiveness. He himself forgive people. Although he is God, people wrong him, he gave life to them. He gave existence. He gave everything. And they use all those things against him. He still forgives. You and me. Sometimes people wrong us. They have nothing to do with us. We didn't give them life. We didn't give them money. We didn't give them anything. And they still wrong us. So you don't want to forgive? Especially when they ask. Especially when they come and say, please forgive me. Like the person who came to Umar and said, I am the one who killed your brother. Anyways, the point is, Allah loves pardoning. This is why Aisha, radiallahu anha, may Allah be pleased with her, because she asked the most important question that all of us should have asked. What should I say? What is the dua I should make if I come across Laylatul Qadr? The Prophet said, forgiveness. Ask Allah to pardon you. Because if Allah pardons you, everything will be okay in your life. In your life, before you die, let alone after death. So it's not just Jannah. Even in life, your life will become very stable, very secure, very peaceful, very fruitful, very tranquil. You will be happy because Allah forgave you. So the malaika swears by the mercy of Allah. Do you know there are 8 angels who carry the throne of Allah? Guys, the throne of Allah is bigger than his kursi. And the kursi of Allah is bigger than heavens and earth. Now imagine. Do you see heavens and earth? This is just the first sky. Yeah? What you see and I see is the first sky, what we call the universe. There are 7 levels. The 7 levels are like this ring. Do you see my ring? In a desert. Compared to what? To the kursi of Allah. And the kursi of Allah is where he put his feet. Kursi doesn't mean chair. The kursi of Allah is where Allah put his feet. The way it befits his majesty, you don't think. So the kursi is like the desert. The heavens and earth like this ring. Then the kursi of Allah compared to the throne is like this ring in another desert. There are 8 angels who carry his throne. So how big are they? Look at me. Every day they say, Rabbana wasi'ta kulla shay'in rahmatan wa ilma. Our Rabb, you have encompassed all in mercy and knowledge. They know Allah is very merciful. They are the closest angels to Allah. So they know Allah is so merciful. Allah himself said, and my mercy encompasses all. It's in the Quran. So seek his forgiveness. All, including you and the guy who disturbed you. The people who give you a hard time. Wait, wait, wait for the questions. I will answer. So I'm going to stop here just for the sake of time and give more time for questions and answers. We continue with the hadith of Allah creating 100 rahmah. Look at me, guys. Allah, when he created the universe, he created 100 rahmah. One rahmah he sent down to earth. This rahmah is enough for all his creations, including birds, including animals. You see the bird, how she feed her babies. She goes put herself in danger to come back to the nest to feed the babies. You see your rahmah to your children. You see your cat with its kittens. That is just one. Enough for all mankind, jinn, animals, and this and that. There are still 99 waiting for Yawm al-Qiyamah. So there is chance for you and me to go to Jannah, inshallah, by the mercy of Allah, by the rahmah of Allah. Is this clear? Ya Allah, 99 rahmas, more waiting for us, yes. So Allah loves that you forgive. Now I know most of you will ask me, Sheikh, can I forgive and not forget? Can I do this and not do that? Fine, ask any question. But most of your questions will be answered at the end of the class. Next time, inshallah, when we do the whole class, you will understand what does forgiveness mean. But for the time being, I advise you and me. Somebody wronged you. And he came and said, please, sister, brother, please, for Allah's sake, forgive me. And here is your amana. Forgive me because I was not a good husband, I was not a good wife, I was not a good father, I was not a good mother, I was not a good son, I took your money, and he wants to give back. You should forgive. You cannot say, I will never forgive you. Especially that he is returning the right or taking back what he said, declaring you innocent with people he has tarnished your reputation with. And you should have the courage, sisters and brothers, to also ask for forgiveness. You know that? When you wrong someone, you should go and ask for forgiveness. That is good. If they don't want, between them and Allah. But you ask. I went to my father and mother or my ex and told him or her, please forgive me. Forgive me for what I said, for what I did. If you took something, take it back and give it back. Let me see some of your questions in the writing. Hold on. Very good.
Okay, I have a question.
Hold on. Hold on, sister. Yes, Uznaini. There is one question here. Salam, Sheikh. If the ones who wronged us and our family is our own close relative, a brother and his family, to a brother and his family. For the sake of Allah, we forgive him and his children. However, like Umar al-Khattab, the hurt was so deep. Can we choose not to cross path or see eye to eye? No. Brother and sister, different. Because you are still family. The one who killed the brother of Umar was not family. So he said to him, please, I don't want to see eye to eye with you because I may, you know, not control my emotions. But this person, especially if he asks forgiveness, he and his family should be, look at me, given a second chance to come home at least Hari Raya. Or whenever there is a wedding and you meet, salam, salam. But you don't have to, salam, salam. I don't have to hug you or sit with you, pretend everything is okay. No, salam, salam. They sit somewhere, we sit somewhere. Or even if we sit together, salam, salam. But the heart is, whatever is in the heart is the heart. But I have forgiven you. Meaning, I'm not going to be the same like before, but I'm not going to harm you. I will not retaliate against you physically or in court, or provided you don't do again what you have done. I know it's tough, I know. This is why forgiveness is very, very high, because it's tough. Because we are humans. And the weaker we are in Iman, the tougher forgiveness will be. The stronger we are in Iman, because look at me, you are thinking about Allah forgiving you on the Day of Judgment too. So you forgive. I forgive you because I want Allah to forgive me. So I'm thinking of God. That's what helps me. No, I'm not thinking of you anymore. You just look like a fly or mosquito to me now. After what you have done, but I am looking at Allah. That's why I'm forgiving you. I know it's difficult. Believe me. I myself find it difficult on many people. Yeah? But we forgive them because we want Allah. We want to please Allah, and we want Allah to forgive us too. Yeah? Yes. Sister Osnaini?
Assalamualaikum, Sheikh.
Assalamu rahmatullah.
Sheikh, we are urged to forgive others. Right?
Sorry?
We are urged to forgive others.
Yes.
So are we supposed to forgive the Zionists for what they are doing to the Palestinians?
No, we're talking about Muslims. You forgive Muslims. Zionists are not Muslims. Good. You forgive a Muslim. A Muslim brother or sister who wronged you. And they even ask you to forgive them. These are the people you forgive. Not a Yahudi, not a Hindu who oppressed you. Look at me. Even a Muslim who oppresses you, don't forgive him until he asks forgiveness. Until he repents. Do you understand? I'm talking about a good Muslim like you. He has problems. He abused you, said bad things about you, he or she or whatever. These people now, they're Muslims. They pray like you. Here you may forgive them. I'm not talking about Oran Kafir or Oran Zalim. Muslim Zalim, don't forgive him until he repents and ask forgiveness. Clear? Osnaini, is this clear? So it's not clear? That's why you don't say yes? Osnaini, where are you?
Yes, I'm here.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Okay, you're welcome.
Thank you so much for the
honor. You're welcome. Yeah, no, don't forgive the Zionists. Don't forgive the Americans. Don't forgive the Russians. Don't forgive Oran Yahudi. Don't forgive Oran Munafiq. Don't forgive those who oppress you and don't repent, even if they are Muslims. I'm talking about a Muslim, a father, a mother, a sister, a husband, a wife, a brother-in-law, sister-in-law, who realized their mistake and they said to you, please forgive us. Should forgive. Don't say, no, you caused me so much pain. No, khalas. So much pain means so much pahala. Guys, so much pain equals so much pahala. If you are patient. Yeah. Okay. We see you, inshallah, next week with another beautiful class about Allah loves forgiveness. ربنا آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم انصر إخواننا المجاهدين في فلسطين. اللهم ثبت أقدامهم وسدد رميهم واخذل عدوك وعدوهم. يا الله, the one who sent 1,000 ملائكة to support 314 men during the Battle of Badr, send 50,000 ملائكة to support our brothers and sisters in Palestine against the Jews, against the Americans, against the British, against the French. May you curse them, Ya Allah. May you destroy them. May you sink their ships. Make their planes never take off and never land. Ya Rab, destroy their economies. Ya Rab, make fitna in their own countries so that they leave the Muslims alone. Amin, amin. Subhanaka Allahumma wa bihamdik. Nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant. Astaghfiruka wa natubu ilayk. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.
Wa alaikum salam wa rahmatullahi.